stumble and fall. Just a few announcements. Vacation Bible School, Totus Tuus. We are in need of housing for our VBS Totus Tuus leaders this summer. The host family will provide rooms for two ladies or two gentlemen starting around 2 p.m. July 13th and ending at 8 a.m. on July 18th. If interested in helping to provide for these young missionaries, please contact Kendall McGrath. In continued support for the victims of the recent tornadoes and severe weather here in Southwest Iowa, we will be having a second collection at all masses next weekend, June 15th and 16th. Please prayerfully consider donating what you can to help those whose lives have been so deeply impacted by the storms. Our main celebrant this evening is Father Jacob. Assisting him is Deacon Darwin. The special intention for this Mass is for Betty and Bernard Kriegler and Gerald Champ. Please rise and let us sing hymn number 730.
Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Brothers and sisters, how good it is to be gathered here in the house of the Lord. In order that we might be worthy to stand before him, we first call to mind our sins and ask his pardon and his peace.
Lord Jesus, you teach us to have faith, to look not to what is seen, but what is unseen. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ Jesus, you teach that a house divided against itself will not be able to stand. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you teach us that we must all be brothers and sisters to one another. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you. We give you thanks for your great glory, Lord God, heavenly King. O God, almighty Father, Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Have mercy on us. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Amen.
Let us pray. O God, from whom all good things come, grant that we who call on you in our need may at your prompting discern what is right, and by your guidance do it. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
A reading from the book of Genesis. After the man, Adam, had eaten of the tree, the Lord God called to the man and asked him, "Where are you?" He answered, "I heard you in the garden, but I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid myself." Then he asked, "Who told you that you were naked? You have eaten then from the tree of which I had forbidden you to eat." The man replied, "The woman whom you put here with me, she gave me the fruit from the tree, and so I ate it." The Lord God then asked the woman, "Why did you do such a thing?" The woman answered, "The serpent tricked me into it, so I ate it." Then the Lord God said to the serpent, "Because you have done this, you shall be banned from all the animals and from all the wild creatures. On your belly shall you crawl, and dirt shall you eat all the days of your life. I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. He will strike at your head, while you strike at his heel." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
There is mercy and fullness of redemption. With the Lord there is mercy and fullness of redemption. Out of the depths I cry to you, O Lord. Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to my voice in supplication. With the Lord there is mercy and
with you your forgiveness, that you may be revered. With the Lord there is mercy and fullness of redemption. I trust in the Lord, my soul trusts in his word. More than sentinels wait for the dawn, let Israel wait for the Lord. With the Lord there is mercy and fullness of redemption. For with the Lord is kindness, and with him is plenteous redemption. And he will redeem Israel for all their iniquities. With the Lord there is mercy and fullness of redemption.
A reading from the second letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, since we have the same spirit of faith, according to what is written, I believed, therefore I spoke, we too believe, and therefore we speak, knowing that the one who raised the Lord Jesus will raise us also with Jesus and place us with you in his presence. Everything indeed is for you, so that the grace bestowed in abundance on more and more people may cause the thanksgiving to overflow for the glory of God. Therefore, we are not discouraged. Rather, although our outer self is wasting away, our inner self is being renewed day by day. For this momentary light affliction is producing for us an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison, as we look not to what is seen, but to what is unseen. For what is seen is transitory, but what is unseen is eternal. For we know that if our earthly dwelling, a tent, should be destroyed, we have a building from God, a dwelling not made with hands, in eternal heaven. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Says the Lord, and when I am lifted up from the earth, I will draw everyone to myself. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord.
Jesus came home with his disciples. Again, the crowd gathered, making it impossible for them to eat. When his relatives heard of this, they set out to seize him, for they said, he is out of his mind. The scribes who had come from Jerusalem said, he is possessed by Beelzebul, and by the prince of demons he drives out demons. Summoning them, he began to speak to them in parables. How can Satan drive out Satan? If a kingdom is divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. And if a house is divided against itself, that house will not be able to stand. And if Satan has risen up against himself and is divided, he cannot stand. That is the end of him. But no one can enter a strong man's house to plunder his property unless he first ties up the strong man. Then he can plunder the house. Amen, I say to you, all sins and all blasphemies that people utter will be forgiven them. But whoever blasphemes against the Holy Spirit will never have forgiveness, but is guilty of everlasting sin. For they had said, he has an unclean spirit. His mother and his brothers arrived. Standing outside, they sent word to him and called him. A crowd seated around him told him, your mother and your brothers and your sisters are outside asking for you. But he said to them in reply, who are my mother and brothers? And looking around the house, seated in the circle, he said, here are my mother and my brothers, for whoever does the will of God is my brother and sister and mother. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Well, there is a lot going on in our gospel reading today, and it can maybe seem like there were three or four different stories in there, and maybe they didn't have much to do with each other. But that is not the case. That's not true. So let's pick it apart a little bit and walk through what we just heard. Sometimes we are tempted, I think especially when we're reading the Bible, because perhaps there are words and things and references that are a little strange to us, and a language, a way of speaking that's a little strange to us, to just kind of let it wash over us and see us say at the end, yes, well, that was very nice, wasn't it? Because we know it was the word of God. But to not actually have paid attention to what is being said here and why this was presented to us. So first of all, at the beginning and at the end, there are these sections about Jesus's family. And then in the middle, there's this other section about, so he's being misunderstood by his family. And then in the middle, we have this section about Jesus being misunderstood and indeed lied about by the authorities, the Jewish authorities. And this can seem to us today a very weird thing, a way of arranging things. But it is the scriptural authors is like one of their favorite ways of arranging things. Having like A and then B and then A again, or sometimes a whole pyramid of different structures, but at the beginning and the end is the same thing. It's one of their favorite ways of doing things. It is not natural for us today to read it, but it evidently was natural for them because they loved doing it. So this is not just these weird random stories put together. Mark is telling us, I want you to understand these together. So we do well to read them together, which we did today. Jesus' family thinks that Jesus is out of his mind, and they are well within their rights to go get him, because, of course, your family has authority over you, but only if they're older than you. So evidently, these are, you know, people, there's been much debate, of course, and much made of his brother and sisters, but these are evidently people older than Jesus because they think they have the authority to go do something about it, so that they certainly can't be his like blood siblings, but his family in the broader sense. And some people are saying he's out of his mind. We'll come back to family at the end because that's where the punchline is. But in general, people are saying Jesus is out of his mind. Now, other people, the scribes who came from Jerusalem to see what this all was about, are evidently not to Jesus' face, but behind his back, telling people that he is possessed by Beelzebub, another name for the devil, and by the prince of demons he drives out demons. And the Lord Jesus does not, because he is a good man, just talk more behind their backs about those guys. He summons them to him, and he confronts them face to face, as we would do well to do in our own lives as well. And step by step, he picks apart the argument that they've made. First of all, but that by the power of demons, he drives out demons. That it's by the power of the devil that he has this authority that he's demonstrated. And basically just shows that this makes no sense, right? That this makes no sense. So he goes step by step. If a kingdom is divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. If a house is divided against itself, that house will not be able to stand. Of course, a reference made very famous to us by Abraham Lincoln. And if Satan has risen up against himself and is divided, he cannot stand. That is the end of him. So often we think of this because like a kingdom, a house, we're like, yeah, he's talking about the kingdom of heaven, but he's not. He's talking about the kingdom of Satan. If it was divided against itself, it would fall down. It makes no sense to say that it's the power of the devil that is working to drive out the devils. And this seems obvious to us, of course, but there's an important lesson here. There is no equivalence between the power of Satan and the power of God. Sometimes we are tempted to imagine these things as though they are equal and opposite, light and dark. Or sometimes even we are tempted to imagine these things as though, well, it's all kind of the same thing and everybody's striving after things. And the power that the Lord Jesus Christ exercises in his ministry, in his work in the world, in his work in our lives, and most of, especially in his salvation, is not at all equivalent to the power of the devil. And that is relevant to our daily lives. Because Satan often does offer us his help with our problems. Maybe not directly, although sometimes directly. But this offer is lies. And it is impossible that Satan is going to solve his own problems. We cannot solve the problems that have come into our lives through sin with more sin. And it is crazy to try, because a kingdom divided against itself cannot stand. If the source of our problems are sin, then they cannot be solved by more sin or by compromise with sin. That applies in the most direct ways through magic or trying to summon things or things like this. And, you know, I tell you, 3 years ago when I was first ordained, I wouldn't have even brought that up in a homily to the people because I thought, well, nobody does things like that. But in 3 years, I have learned otherwise. Yes, some people do fall for these horrible things, that as though by magic or deals with Satanism or something, they could solve their problems. But these things are lies, and a Christian certainly must stay, well, they're superstition at best, certainly unworthy of a Christian, or far worse, and we must have nothing to do with them. But perhaps more everyday, even our more everyday sins, which so often, why do we fall into them? Because there's some offer there. We don't do them just to spite ourselves. We do them because there's some offer there. That by making this deal, or by doing this thing, we're going to get to what's good. That I'm going to get to the freedom that I desire if I just will put myself a little bit further into slavery to my senses, or this appetite that dominates me, or the way these other people think. As though I'm going to get to freedom by going just a little bit deeper into slavery. And when, of course, you say it like that, Father, it sounds crazy. because it is crazy, but it is such an attractive and alluring thing, and we fall for it all the time. I'm going to get to satisfaction, you know, to feel like I have enough by just going a little bit deeper into that greed that is ruling me right now, whether that is for money or for power or pleasure or honor or whatever it would be. Going just a little bit deeper into that greed, then I'll get to enough, which of course is crazy because greed is the opposite of satisfaction. We are very often duped into thinking that what we need is a better deal with the devil, as though we can go renegotiate it and get something better out of it. Whether that is from these lies I've maybe mentioned just now, or even just these halfway deals. Well, yes, Father, I really do hate my brother, but only just in my mind. I don't say it out loud. Well, fine, I suppose. There is some sense of real progress there, but if we think that by this halfway mark, this arrangement with the kingdom of Satan, that we have found ourselves freedom, we're fooling ourselves, and worse than fooling ourselves. Well, yes, I really do can't control myself in this particular appetite, but I've set these limits around it. Well, okay, I suppose that is better than not having set those limits. But if we're thinking that this is the arrangement that's going to bring us to freedom and the joy and the peace that the Lord has promised us, we're worse than fooling ourselves. These are lies from the devil and a kingdom, and we won't find freedom with a better deal with the evil one. We don't need a better deal with the devil, who is a liar from the beginning, as we heard about in our first reading. We need what was promised right at the very beginning. We need someone to crush his head. That's what we need. We don't need a better deal with the devil. We need someone to crush his head. And that's what we hear about here. No one can enter a strong man's house to plunder his property unless he first ties up the strong man. Then he can plunder the house. So we do well to remember, who is the strong man in this story with the house? The strong man is the devil, who evidently has a rich house, which is the world. And you might think, well, the world doesn't belong to the devil. Not in any absolute way, but of course, what does God himself call the devil? He calls him the God of this world. He calls him the prince of the world. And over and over again, the scriptures, whenever it talks about the world, is usually talking about evil and wickedness. So no, it's true, the world doesn't belong to the devil, and there are many good things in this world. But it's also true, every time Jesus wants to talk about what's bad and is going to lead us astray, he talks about the world. And he talks about this house with many possessions in it, and the strong man in possession of the house is the devil. The burglar, the one sneaking in to plunder it, this is the Lord Jesus Christ, who's going to bind the strong man and then plunder his possessions. Who are the possessions? Of course, humanity is the possessions of the Lord Jesus, of the devil. Now, this, of course, is before. This, of course, is the Lord Jesus plundering the possessions of the devil before the definitive crushing of his head, right? Before the cross. A Christian does not belong to the devil. And you have not just been plundered, although you have been. You've been brought out from that house. We do that, of course, at every baptism. We're going to have a baptism tomorrow at the 10 o'clock Mass, or the 8 o'clock Mass. At one of the Masses tomorrow, we'll have a baptism. And what do? We don't just say, yes, how good and how true this person belongs to the kingdom of God, right? First, we do a renunciation. You have to renounce Satan and all his works and all his empty promises, and then you belong to the kingdom of heaven. We do an exorcism on the little baby too. Not because we think that that baby, like, specifically is possessed by the devil, but because in general, what are we doing? We are being plundered. We're being brought out from slavery for the one who, you know, owned us, the devil, brought out into the kingdom of his glorious light, into the kingdom of the Lord Jesus Christ. So now we hear about blasphemies, being forgiven, but whoever blasphemes against the Holy Spirit will never have forgiveness, but is guilty of an everlasting sin. What does this mean? And should I be discouraged about it or not? Well, no. A blasphemy against the Holy Spirit, the way I think we ought to understand it, because of what else we've heard today, is the one either who says that what is wicked is good and what is good is wicked. The one either who says, you know what I want? I want to stay in this house. I want to stay with the devil. I want this deal with the devil. And I'm very happy here. Thank you very much. This would be a blasphemy against the Holy Spirit because it says what God offers me, I don't want. And again, this is not a crazy, impossible thing to say, and we have probably said it. The things the Lord offers us are beautiful indeed, but they can feel hard. And we can be tempted, like the Israelites right after, right? Why did you bring us out of Egypt? At least, and they longed for the onions of Egypt or for the flesh pots of Egypt, right? The apostles said the same thing a couple times, over and over again. Basically, the whole history of God's salvation is the history of people saying, God, why are you even doing this? I had it better before. That wasn't true in any one of those cases, and it's not true in your life either, but it is not some impossible to imagine situation. In fact, it's a very easy situation to fall into. We have to want what God's offering. He won't make it us take it. And if we stubbornly refuse to take it, then we won't receive what he wants to give us. And then again, to prefer slavery to freedom, to prefer greed to satisfaction, to prefer death to life, this is to blaspheme against the Holy Spirit. And as long as we persist in that, indeed, there is no forgiveness because we don't want it and we won't have it and we've chosen against it. And finally, we arrive. His mother and his brothers and sisters are outside asking for him. And he says in reply, who are my mother and my brothers? Here are my mother and my brothers. And of course, these disciples gathered here with the Lord. We ought to hear the same thing. He says that to us as well. Not that we're doing his will perfectly and completely, but we are doing his will faithfully, please God. And we can grow in it to do it more. But that's what faithfully means, faithfully every day coming back. Lord, help me to do your will today and a little more today than yesterday. We can do the will of God. In this life, we can't do it perfectly, but we can do it faithfully, coming back day after day to live it. And that is to be a mother and brother, a mother and sibling. And this is a beautiful thing. A tremendously beautiful thing. It is not enough just to be plundered from the house of the devil, to be carried off. The Lord could have just done that and it would have been enough and we would have praised his name forever. But he does even more for us. He brings us into his family, shares his very life with us, makes us his siblings, and then a mother, he mentions as well. What a beautiful thing. Not just his sibling to share his life. Again, it would have been enough, and we would have praised his name forever for so great a gift. But he makes us also to be, in a certain way, a mother of Christ. He never calls us a father, because, of course, Christ has one father in heaven. But we can be, every Christian is called to be a mother of Christ by, like Mary, to receive the Holy Spirit, to receive what God himself, who has given to us, and then to bring him out into the world, right? Every good gift that a Christian does united with God is to mother Christ into the world a little bit. Every time we share the grace of God and the work of the Holy Spirit with someone else, we mother Christ into the world. Whenever we would witness to the good things God has done for us, we are, in this little way, a mother of Christ in the world. To be his mother and his brothers, to do the will of God. It is not enough just to be carried out, although that is a great start. It's not enough for God just to save us from the foolishness we've fallen into, although he starts there. He wants even more for us. So indeed, there's a lot going on in our gospel today. There's a lot going on. The kingdom of the devil is not divided against itself, and we are fools if we act like it is. If we act like, by just going a little bit further into this particular slavery in my life, I'll finally find freedom. As though I can make a deal with the devil and get out of our fallen state. Or as though I can get a better deal with the devil and a better negotiation than what Adam and Eve got out of him. It's a lie, and it won't lead to anything good. We don't need a better deal with the devil. We need someone who will crush his head, who will take us out of this horrible and unsolvable situation. And not just take us out of it, but then do even more, make us his brothers and sisters. Make us a part of his family. Make us share his very life. This is what we have in the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's not settle for anything less.
Brothers and sisters, together we profess the faith.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty,
maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnated of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance to the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds with the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
We are gathered together in the Lord Jesus Christ, who conquers all evil. So we come confidently to the Father with our intentions and our needs.
For our Holy Father, our bishops, priests, and deacons, that they may keep us true to our faith in Christ, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who believe, that they may have the courage to speak out boldly in the name of Jesus Christ, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those suffering from physical or emotional abuse, that efforts to heal and free them may succeed, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all our families in this community, that doing the will of God, they may be truly the brothers and sisters of Christ, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our sick and for our bereaved, and for those parishioners that cannot be here with us today to celebrate this Mass, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the souls of the departed, that they may come to that everlasting home not made by human hands, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let's pray also for ourselves, that in all those places where we perhaps have made compromises with sin and with evil, we may receive the freedom of Christ, who crushes the head of the ancient serpent. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And let's pray also for the National Eucharistic Pilgrimage, and in particular for our place in the National Eucharistic Pilgrimage, June 23rd, that God will give success and great graces through this blessed event. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Almighty God and Father, as we offer our prayers, we thank you for our Son, the conqueror of sin and death, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Our preparation song is number 505, Only This I Want, number 505. Good tease, good tease.
This I want, but to know the Lord and to bear his cross, so to wear the crown he wore. But this is love. To gain the Lord is to gain all I need. Only this I want, but to know the Lord and to bear his cross, so to wear.
Brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice of your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and good of all his holy church.
Look kindly upon our service, O Lord, we pray, that what we offer may be an acceptable oblation to you and lead us to grow in charity through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord Holy Father, almighty and eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For through his paschal mystery, he accomplished the marvelous deed by which he has freed us from the yoke of sin and death, summoning us to the glory of being now called a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for your own possession, to proclaim everywhere your mighty works, for you have called us out of darkness into your own wonderful light. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim.
Holy, holy, holy. comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and William, our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, to whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity, in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other a sign of Christ's peace.
God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Grant us peace. Behold
the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter into my room, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
The Lord is my rock, my fortress, and my deliverer. My God is my saving strength.
Our communion song is number 389, I'm sorry, Here I Am, Lord, 389.
By the Lord of seas,
sea and skies. I have heard my people cry, all who dwell in dark and sin, my hand will save. I who made the stars at night, I will make the darkness bright. Who will prepare my life to them? Who shall I say? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? Have I heard you calling in the night? I will go, Lord, if you lead me. I will hold your people in my heart. I'm the Lord of snow and rain. I have borne my people's pain. I have wept for love of them. They turn away. I will break their hearts of stone. Give them hearts for love alone. I will speak my word to them. Who shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you lead me. I will hold your people in my heart. I, the Lord of wind and flame, I will tend the poor and lame. I will set a feast for them. My hand will save. Finest bread I will provide till their hearts be satisfied. I will give my life to them. Who shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will
the Ania Christi on the overhead.
Soul of my Savior, sanctify my life. Body of Jesus,
me in your tide. Wash me with water flowing from your side. Strength and protection, may your passion be. Blessed Jesus, hear and answer me. Deep in your wounds, Lord, hide and shelter me. So shall I never, never part from thee. Guard and defend.
May your healing work, O Lord, free us, we pray, from doing evil, and lead us to what is right. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Just to briefly reiterate, we will have a second collection for the victims of severe weather in Southwest Iowa at all our masses next weekend. I know we did that already a few weeks ago, but we've had a lot more severe weather. So we're going to do it again. Please do consider continuing to be generous to that collection. Vacation Bible School is the week of July 13th. It's very exciting. It's the same program we had last year, and it got rave reviews. You can ask at least one of the alumna is here. And so please do consider signing up. Also, we need some people to host, preferably who live kind of nearby, to host the male and female volunteers who help run it. And most of you saw on the way in those posters for the National Eucharistic Pilgrimage, which is coming to Omaha and Council Bluffs Sunday, June 23rd. We didn't have our normal Corpus Christi procession last Sunday for the Feast of Corpus Christi because on Sunday, June 23rd, just a couple weeks away, we are going to have a great big procession together with the Archdiocese of Omaha from St. Cecilia's Cathedral down to through Creighton's campus, around the College World Series, over the bridge, and then here to Corpus Christi Parish. You can participate in any number of combinations of those events. We're going to have a wonderful mass outdoors at River's Edge Park at 1:30 in the afternoon, that Sunday afternoon, and then receive the Blessed Sacrament from that procession coming down from Omaha. So that is where I'll be. You want to start it at the cathedral and walk the whole 6 mile route. It's not an impossible thing for many of you anyway. So please do consider doing that. Maybe you want to walk just the mile and a half from River's Edge Park. Maybe that's too far for you to walk and you want to find a place along the route to wait for the Lord to come to you. What a blessing. Then once we arrive here and have the benediction from Bishop Johnson, and more importantly, from the Lord, we'll have a dinner over in the Great Hall, and then we have adoration going all night. Some of you are part of groups that have signed up for that. The Altar and Rosary Society has an hour. The Knights of Columbus have an hour. The youth group has an hour. But you're welcome anytime, all night. So please do come, at least for, even if it's just for 15 minutes, please do come and pray before the Lord present here on the altar in the Blessed Sacrament. This is the Lord who was promised to us that he would crush the head of the devil. We don't come to him through compromises with sin or by one more lie. We come to him when we want to come to him and when we're willing to let him take us out of the domain of sin and death and to live in his kingdom, which is the kingdom of life. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Go glorifying God by your lives.
Thanks be to God.
Our sending forth song is number 590, Companions on a Journey.
We are companions on a journey, breaking bread and sharing life. And in the love we bear is the hope we share. For we believe in the love of our God. We believe in the love of our God. The lumber strangers to each other, the longer strangers in God's house. We are fed and we are natives by the strength of those who care, by the strength of those who care. We are companions on a journey, breaking bread and sharing life. And in the love we bear is the hope we share. For we believe in the love of our God. We believe in the love of our
Florida, it's 103.
I know.
If not, we'll
I
just
know
not
that
see.
Has to be just done.